700 Club presents Heart to Heart with Sheila Walsh.
Hello and welcome to Heart to Heart. Well, during his past career in secular music, my guest today sold over 2 million records and performed with Billy Joel, Little Richard, Eric Clapton, and many others. Since then, the message of his songs has drastically changed, and so has he, but his rock and roll approach remains a trademark. Watch this. Denomination Demolition is from his latest album, Crank It Up. And you might be interested to know that all his band and road crew are either ordained ministers or studying to be ministers. Here to tell us more about what's at the heart of his music is the Grammy and Dove Award winning artist from Atlanta, Georgia. You guessed it, Mylon Lefevre. Welcome, my friend. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Demolition? Denomination Demolition?
That's right. Get back to Jesus. Love is what the gospel's all about.
Did you write that out of things that you saw as you travel? I mean, you're on the road a lot. You travel around. Do you think denominationalism has been a destructive force in the country?
I think that in these last days, the Lord wants to pour out his spirit on all mankind, and of course, through the church. And just the purpose of the song was to encourage unity, and what causes unity is love. And the simple message of the gospel is just that all these things working without love are useless to the Lord and to the church. So, you know, we just wanted to, obviously a little tongue-in-cheek silliness there, but making fun of ourselves, all the silly reasons we find to divide the church and argue, and just trying to bring them all up and say, hey, it's not worth it. We just need to, love really is what the gospel is about.
Now, you were brought up in a real gospel tradition. Your family were pretty strict when you were growing up.
Yes, ma'am.
What did it mean to you, though, in your heart? Did any of it make sense to you as a kid?
I think I inherited religion. But, we went to church all the time, but we didn't spend much time in prayer. Like if the pastor came over on Sunday, you know, for dinner. And we had a Bible, but we didn't read it. We just went to church a lot. Mm. And I believed that Jesus was the Son of God, but I didn't know him. And I didn't spend, I knew about him. I just didn't know him. Mm. That's all.
You were very successful, though, even as a kid. I mean, when you were you cut your first gospel record when you were 12 years old?
12.
A solo record?
I didn't write that song. I just, I just sung on my parents' albums. I was about 17 when I started producing and writing. My parents owned the studio, and I could go over there late at night and learn to play the instruments. Not very well, but if you've got all night and you can erase all your mistakes, So I'd play one instrument at a time and then play another one. And I was a writer. I desired to be a writer. And once people started, Elvis cut a song I'd written when I was about 17. I was a senior in high school. And which was really wonderful, and it made me money, and it allowed me to be accepted as a writer. And Oak Ridge Boys and all the Gaithers and the Imperials, all those kind of groups. But nobody cut it the way I heard it. Mm. And I had to go in the studio and put it on tape if anybody was ever going to hear what I was hearing. So the original, you know, the first few albums I did, that was the purpose. It wasn't to be an artist. It was just to share the music.
But even though you wrote wonderful gospel songs that other groups used and that God used those songs to change people's lives, in your own heart there was no peace.
I think, well, you know, I mean, you and I have toured together and we're old friends. And I know you know the answers to all these questions, and yet...
But they don't know!
That's right. But, you know, I think God allows us to be tested. And I did go to school, I did go to Sunday school when I was a kid, and the Word did go in my heart, and even though I didn't really study it, I wasn't studying to show myself approved unto God. I went to those Sunday school classes, and I studied just because I was there. But I think God allows circumstances to come about where your faith is tested and you find out if you don't have any faith, you fail the test. And that's what happened to me in life. I think that making so much money so young was really hard because success seemed so easy. I put together a little band that later on became the Atlanta Rhythm Section, and we started making music, and we just made a lot of money, sold a lot of records, and I started pursuing this thing. I refer to it as American Dream. It just says if you make enough money where you can do what you want to, that you'll be happy. Mm-hmm. And I think that became an idol and a god to me. And I never really worshiped there, and yet I did because I spent all my time, you know, reading, writing, thinking music, studying how the best musicians did it. And that image, I think, in my mind of being a successful musician was more important to me than learning how to be God's child and how to have an integrity relationship with Him.
How did you ever find your way back to the Lord then? Because I know that you almost at one point lost your life and you got involved in kind of wild lifestyle.
Well, praise God, He's very patient with us. And He sent this band called the Second Chapter of Acts to Atlanta. And I had known Buck, the leader of the group. I had known him. We had done some projects together. He'd asked me to write on an album for a guy named Sammy Johns, and I'd done some background vocals and written a song for him. And, you know, Buck came in, and I ran into him at church. Oh, Andre Crouch came to Atlanta and invited me to go out and do some dates with him. And I can't remember who all was on that. He just had a whole bunch of new Christians. We're all out, so we were in L.A., and two of the guys in the band, Hadley and Harlan, invited me to go to church with them, went to the church on the way, and sat behind Buck and Annie by accident, right? So the next time they came to, and we just got to talking, and went over to their house and had dinner, that they invited me home for lunch. When they came to Atlanta, they shared the Lord with me, and God just really broke my heart, showed me that I hadn't been... I had accepted Him in my teens as the Savior of the world, but I had never accepted Him as my Lord and my Master. And I never trusted Him with anything but the sins and the stuff that I was ashamed of and that I didn't want. I'd never trusted Him with my dreams and my hopes, my relationships, you know.
How did that change your music?
Oh, man. I think worship is a natural thing to do now, and praise, and celebrating who God is and what His Word means. You know, songwriters write they're like diaries. Songs are really just musical diaries. They just tell what's going on in your life. And so that's what they still are. Instead of writing about women and drugs, I'm writing about what really counts. Because God, when Christ came into my heart, it changed my life in such a wonderful way that it's impossible for me to ignore. Because it affects my relationship with my wife, of course. I mean, I have holy matrimony now. I used to just be married, you know. And my relationship with my child, my mom, dad, brothers, sisters. The band, I've never had a band until I got born again that didn't do drugs and didn't come in every you know, we would go and rehearse, and before Christ, you would go and rehearse and rehearse and rehearse, but it didn't matter how much you rehearsed, because whatever you took before you went on stage was going to change the way you played it anyway. You know, now it's amazing. We have a group that prays together, and...
You have a great bunch of guys.
Oh, man, you know, they love Jesus.
In fact, you know what I remember most? Do you remember when we toured together that Norman, my Norman's stepmom died during the tour?
Yes,
and
yes.
He was going to have to fly home. And we were kind of financially strapped at the time, and we prayed and asked the Lord to provide the money, and we didn't tell anyone. And every one of your guys, even though I know they do not have a lot of money, every one of them put something in, and when it was all added up, it was enough to buy the ticket for Norman to fly home. They're wonderful guys.
That's cool. I'd forgotten that.
I didn't forget it. Neither is Norman. We're going to take a short break, and we're going to talk more about Broken Heart, about the ministry, about what they do out there with kids, and about this wonderful new album. It's called Crank It Up. And if I had to use one adjective to describe it, it would just be joy. There's so much joy in this music. And we'll talk a bit more about that when we come back, so stay tuned.
I don't know what's going on in your life, but I just want to encourage these songs that we sing. They're about God because He's changed our life in such a good way that I can't ignore it. I used to just be a musician. Man, I gave my life to Christ about 10 years ago, and he has changed every part of my life in such a wonderful way that I know that the truth about Him is the good news. And I just wanted to take just a minute and actually just say to you what I believe. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and I believe He's alive, that God has raised Him from the dead. And it's not just a matter of getting religion or joining a certain denomination. But man, I just wanted to take just a minute and encourage you to find out the truth about who God is and how He does things so that you can start enjoying His presence in your life. If you've never accepted Christ, it's very simple. Romans 10:9-10 says this. If you believe that Jesus is the Son of God and you believe that God has raised Him from the dead, if you'll confess Jesus with your lips as the Lord of your life, you'll be saved. And God knows what He meant when He said that.
Now that is on the end of Mylon's new music video. It's called Crank It Up. And right on the end, you have there really laid out a clear gospel presentation. As long as I've known you, you've always been that way. You've always been a black or white person. And you go for things with all your heart. What happens at a Broken Heart concert?
Well, you know, we rock them and have a good time with them and let those who aren't used to going and being around Christians relax a little bit. We do songs in the beginning of the concert that are just fun, celebration type stuff. And yet we really work hard. You know, you can't do the kind of music we do without sweating. You know, it's hard work. And we just, there's a lot of production. We blow some things up and just have some fun with them, you know. Scream and holler and stomp a little bit. As we go into the evening, the songs get about deeper subjects, and we share all of our songs, as you know, are just practical application of the Word of God to what's going on in our lives. And I even think, looking back on the songs that we're doing now on this year's tour, the Crank It Up tour, they were prophetic when we wrote them, and we didn't really know it. We were just going through some struggles and seeking God. And I mean, you know, when it comes time to write, we just take a time of fasting and prayer and just say, okay, Lord, it's your kingdom. This is your word, and we're just your kids. We don't care what we sing or preach about. Just, you know, let us know. So as the night goes on, the concert goes on, subjects get a little deeper. At one point, we stop and share, and I preach a little.
Preach a little, like, well, 40 minutes.
No, I've actually, as the Lord renews my mind, you know, I took a lot of drugs before I came to Christ, but God is renewing my mind, and His Word is easier to retain and more organized, and that allows me to give the information. The gospel really is simple, and yet there are a lot of Christians that come to our concerts because they're contemporary Christian concerts, and I really want to challenge those folks to a deeper walk and to the Lordship of Christ. So I am trying to shorten that some, but the guys do razz me. And then we do a little worship, You know, you can't lead someone in worship who hasn't yet accepted Christ, so we give them a chance so that there's no us and them. You know, if the Christians start worshiping immediately, everybody who's not a Christian gets left out and the audience gets separated. We try to wait until they've been explained the gospel, where they understand, where the Lord is dealing with the word, which, as you know, never comes back void. And faith comes from hearing it. And as people have faith to receive from God, he proves that he's God. You know, and then people can enter in and worship him. And, you know, we end up with songs that leave them thinking, hopefully. And give an invitation at the end, allow those who come forward or who make a decision to come to a room where we can be a little bit more intimate with them, pray with them. Those people who make a decision to accept Christ for the first time get a series of letters, which took me, by the way, 2 years to write. I can't believe
it. I read every one of them this morning. They're incredible. Like, I mean, they explain the gospel, great scripture references, and you keep sending them out to follow kids up.
There's five letters for a new Christian, and they get one about every 10 days until they get those five letters. And they're just love letters from the Lord. You know, they're right out. I mean, I interpret them a little bit, and I add, you know, my thoughts to them, but they're just encouragement from God's Word. We want to get those people into a good church, where, and into a good Bible study, and into a fellowship where they can learn to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth, and learn to serve him, get involved, not just go to a building with a steeple, but really, really get involved in the body of Christ. Learn how to use whatever gifts and talents God's given them to extend his kingdom. It is as you know, it's a lifestyle.
I really would like to encourage you to get hold of this stuff. There's the video, the tape. It's time to do Christmas shopping, folks. And the CD, and honestly, maybe you think, well, this music's maybe too progressive for me. You would love it. If you love the Lord, you're going to love this music. And I would encourage you to get hold of it. There's an 800 number there on your screen, 1-800-288-4769. And let me also put up an address for Mylon's ministry. That's Broken Heart Ministry, Post Office Box 1287, Marietta, Georgia, 30061. Broken Heart Ministry, Post Office Box 1287, Marietta, Georgia, 30061.